Palm trees disappearing because of Easter celebrations, and I say Pro Harvest worked with the Catholic Church to stop that, protect the palm trees, and now the parrots are coming back. So it is not too late. All of the money that you've spent here is going to great causes, and I'm going to talk a little bit about what the money from this year's bird fair is going to in the second part of my talk, where I'm going to show some more clips from Colombia, but also some clips from another series I did called Untamed China, and also tell you about why I became besotted with birds when I was 21 or 22. But great to see you all here, and if anyone's got any questions now, I can answer some questions. I've also got, if any of the children want DVDs or anything like that, I've got some dinosaur DVDs and also some DVDs of Untamed China and another series I did about penguins in South Georgia, so I can sign them for you if you'd like any of those. But if anyone's got any questions now, I'll also answer questions at the end of the second session. Can't see out there. I've heard a little bit about it. I'm not an expert on that particular kind of dinosaur, but you know, they didn't think Komodo dragons were venomous, and they thought it was because of toxic bacteria in the saliva, but they've now found that they may actually have venom glands. You've probably read about that. They think that they are actually venomous. So, you know, quite a lot of the stuff that we did in prehistoric park or walking with dinosaurs, they compare dinosaurs with contemporary animals. I mean, of course, skin of a dinosaur never fossilizes, so we don't know whether they had colorful skins, but many modern reptiles do. We're never going to know unless there is a time traveling machine. So, you know, unless they can find a fossil with the venom glands inside.
They have found one, but the skull's in that preserved, and some think that isn't a venom gland.
Yeah, so.
Also, another thing, obviously, we'll say they've got very long teeth, and they're very similar to the Gila monster.
Yeah, which of course the Gila monster and beaded lizard are the only two venomous lizards. So maybe you've got to travel back in time and see if you can catch one, and then we'll see whether they're venomous or not. But yeah, no, but they probably are. I mean, most of the things, you know, the diversity we find today, you did find back in prehistoric times with dinosaurs. My favourite animal, you see, is not a dinosaur. It's a descendant of the dinosaurs, a peregrine falcon. I don't eat meat, but I'd like to fly. I wouldn't like to eat pigeons like a peregrine falcon does, but I'd like to fly like one. Imagine flying over 100 miles an hour and swooping over a sea cliff and swooping down for prey. So my favourite is a peregrine falcon. My favourite dinosaur, as you saw there, is the Microraptor, because it's a nice little one, the same size as a bird. But I'm glad you're a fan of Prehistoric Park. And any parents that are here whose children have the DVD and you've had to watch it 10,000 times as well, I'm very sorry about that. Yes?
You mentioned Colombia is now safe. What's the attitude of the government and people there to conservation?
I was very impressed by the
attitude. Can you repeat the question, please?
Yeah, the question was, what's the attitude by the government and people to conservation in Colombia? I was very impressed, because quite a lot of the country has been set aside for national. Of course, you get the normal problems with development, but quite a lot of the country is set aside in national parks. You do not see people catching birds like they do in China. You know, for the cage trade, people really love their wildlife. There was a lot of landslides in Colombia, and the government realised that was because the forests had been cut down in the watershed. So actually, that place Rio Blanco, where the ant pitters are, is a reserve paid for by the water company because they realised that if they didn't protect the forest, the trees would, the water would cause landslides. So it's for those sort of Latin America countries, I was very impressed by the. And of course, there are so many birders going there now. It's bringing a lot of money into the economy, and the Colombians realise how important ecotourism is. And I went there, of course, not knowing whether I'd like it. I'd always wanted to go there because of the diversity of birds, but the food's lovely. We never had any problems at all. Mexico and Venezuela are dangerous now, but Colombia, really has got its house in order. And it's a wonderful country. I mean, the birds are, humpback whales on the Pacific coast, 2,000 humpback whales go there, so you can get wonderful views of breaching humpback whales. And Santa Marta, you'll see a clip of that in a minute, but it's like a landlocked Galapagos. There's so many different species there that are found nowhere else. So it's a wondrous place. And anywhere where you can, in my mind, anywhere you can see anacondas can't be bad. Yep, and you.
What's your favourite country for wildlife?
Oh, that's a difficult one. Country for wildlife. The thing is, maybe because I make television programmes, and a television programme is made up of short 6-second sequences, I like moving on all the time. So at the moment I love Colombia, but next year it may be Tanzania or wherever I'm filming. So. All of the countries that I go to, they've always got something to offer. I mean, Colombia, both Colombia and China, where I've been for the last few years, have wonderful animals. I mean, ever since I was your age, I wanted to see a giant panda in the wild, and I've done that. And giant salamanders in China, you'll see a picture of one of those in a minute. So China, Colombia, but everywhere's nice. I like everywhere, really. America has some wonderful national parks and some wonderful birds, so it's a very difficult question. But I think my favourite place on Earth, if you pushed me, is a place called Lord Howe Island, which is off the Australian coast, and there's no cars allowed there, and there's a very rare bird there called the Lord Howe Island Rail. And in fact, I took David Attenborough there when we worked together on Life of Birds. There's a rare petrel at the top of Mount Gower, and if you clap like that, these big petrels fall down from the sky and land at your feet, and nobody's sure why they do it. So it's an amazing place, and David Attenborough's just gone back there to see the Lord Howe Island stick insect, which has come back from the brink of extinction, and he wanted to go back and see it, so it's obviously one of his favourite places as well. So Lord Howe Island, if you ever get the chance, it's you would take a flight from Sydney. Great. Well, if anyone wants any DVDs, I'll be here, and then I can answer some more questions at the end of the next session. Thank you very much. Thank you. Eventually, there's more unique species to this one mountain range than there are on the Galapagos Islands. We filmed amazing things, the Santa Marta night monkey, which is like almost like a bush baby. I mean, it's a true monkey that runs around. You can see that next to the lodge. And there's some very, very special birds there as well. Another hummingbird. This is an Inca. They're common all over Colombia, but there's some other unique birds on the Santa Marta mountain. Three species of hummingbirds that we filmed for the show, and you can't see them anywhere else on Earth. The white-tailed star frontlet is one of them. We've got an amazing sequence of that defending its feeding area. A beautiful, beautiful hummingbird. And this is the crew, again, Mike Hutchinson, Alex, who works in my office. And there's Miles McMullen. He's done a brilliant new book about the birds of Colombia, a real pocket guide with all of the species that you can see there. You'll see him in a minute in the film. He lives in Colombia now, originally came from Ireland, and he's an expert on the region. And the great thing about these films are, I'm very excited, you'll see Untamed China, clips from that in a minute. You see a Chinese guy there, Lee is his name. And they are taking Columbia in China. They work for a company called Hunan TV. It's the second largest television channel in China, so you know a great show here would get maybe 10 million viewers. A good show over there with a population of 1.5 billion people, you can imagine how many viewers it gets. And the Chinese are getting a real thirst for wildlife now, so this Chinese crew were tracking us on our filming. They were doing a behind the scenes film, and they are going to show the Columbia series in China when it's shown in the UK, so that will get a huge audience. And it's great because with Untamed China and Columbia, it's getting an interest in China in wildlife, which is of course very, very important with 1.5 billion people there. And there are still some, they still trap songbirds if you go to markets in Beijing, but there's a lot of bird watching societies there. There's a place called Chengdu, which is the capital of Sichuan. They're trying to have a bird fair, obviously not as big as this one, but their own Chinese bird fair. There's lots of young people in China very interested in animals, so it's great that my shows are shown there to generate interest there. So I'm a bit worried about what the behind the scenes is going to show, to be honest, but other than that, hopefully we're going to be okay. I know that the cameraman there has got a website in China now. They call him Shining Superman because he hangs out of the car to film me and everything, holding on with one arm, so he's got a big fan club in China now. But this is the track up to Santa Marta Mountain. The lodge there is called El Dorado. And on the first morning, we saw the night monkeys. We're filming late into the night. We got up before sunrise to go high into the mountain. There's some extraordinary birds that you find up there. One special bird, which is the flagship of the reserve. We were very lucky to see it and get some amazing film of it. You have to go up very early because these birds are only found on this high plateau, and as the morning progresses the wind picks up and they're blown down into dense forest, so you really need to see them very early in the morning. But here's some of the special birds of Santa Marta Mountain.
To build on that brilliant beginning, the next day Miles and I are up before sunrise. This gives us the best chance to see a colourful picture as to the flagship species of the reserve.
It's obviously filmed at night.
Later in the day, the wind usually picks up, pushing them into dense woodland where they're much harder to see. Here on the beach, the forest is much more open, with trees festooned with Spanish moss and colourful green grass. We soon spot a Santa Marta brushfish, splendid in blue and gold. Another special, a subspecies of the emerald toucanet that's only found here on the Santa Marta Range.
Caribbean episode of the Wild Columbia series. And if you climb down from the mountain, on the way down we found boa constrictors. Colombian boa constrictors have a reputation for being very temperamental. I remember when I was a little boy, you can't buy them now, which is great news. They're not imported anymore, but you could when I was a kid. And they had a, you know, they were very, very snappy. So I caught one in the wild, and I must say, it is the most aggressive snake that I've ever seen. Of course, it was sunbathing. Of course, it was going to try to bite. I just picked it up and disturbed its sunbathing. But they certainly have a reputation for being aggressive. And I must say, there is one fantastic, in all my career as a wildlife presenter, particularly a guy with snakes, I've always wanted to be bitten on the nose by a snake, a non-venomous snake, of course. And it happened in Colombia. There's a great tree boa, the Central American tree boa. You found it in the mangrove swamps around this place here, the Los Flamencos Reserve. I was talking about it, and then it bit me on the nose. That's going to be in the titles of the series, and the amount of blood that came out of my nose from there. But as I say, wildlife guys like me, that's a badge of courage to have a pinpricks in your nose from a snake. But if you go down from Santa Marta Mountain, the Guajira Peninsula, it's the driest place in Colombia, less than 4 centimetres of rain every year. This is a brackish lagoon. You see the cameraman, Mike Hutchinson, filming me there. I'm talking about that. Actually, the Santa Marta Mountain, where we've just come from in the story, is higher in the clouds just above us here. And we're filming the very special animals that you find in the desert. The cascabel, the rattlesnake I showed you at the beginning, is one of them. And there's Miles there when we go as a wildlife film crew. Of course, some of the bird sounds, some of the calls, nobody would have them in a library, so we have